We have huge deficits in infrastructure. Many children are out of school. If that is our context, we will be callous and irresponsible if we don't come together and work together to ensure that we sort out these grave problems that threaten our people every single day. The dogmatic emphasis on procedural niceties is a luxury we can't afford. In any event, there is no pure practice of the doctrine of separation of powers. There is no pure practice of it anywhere. The Anglo-American tradition that we hold on to in support of the concept of separation of powers is not pure. So, for example, as many of us know, the U.S. Vice President serves as the President of Senate in the U.S., and he presides over the Senate's daily proceedings. In the absence of the Vice President, the Senate President pro tempore and others who he may designate are the ones who now sit in his place. So even in the U.S., which is supposed to be the center of the great traditions of the separation of powers, they are realistic enough to understand that there must be a bridge, which is why the U.S. Vice President is the President of Senate. So there is no pure practice of this. In the UK, we all know that every minister must be a member of the House of Commons. Every minister must be a member of the House of Commons. If you don't win elections in the House of Commons, they find a way of putting you in the House of Lords where there is no election. They just appoint you so that you can be a minister. So it means that if that were in Nigeria, ministers will either be senators or members of the House of Representatives. And it will make competition even more, it will make the competition even more so, you know, because obviously it will mean that if you want to appoint a person a minister, you go and put him up for elections first. So these countries we look up to recognize that there is no strict separation of powers, and that if it is too strictly enforced, we will impede development and will impede governance, and will shortchange our people. So my brothers and sisters, I think it's time for us to focus on what we have been elected or appointed to do. It is about the welfare of our people. The law and practice as between parliament and the executive is a means to an end. It's not an end in itself. The means must not be allowed to jeopardize the end. Our people just want food on their table, shelter over their heads, clothing on their bodies, healthcare and education for their children and themselves. So the good legislator or the good minister is not the one who is waiving the law and procedure and doctrines. It's the one who says that the spirit of our constitution is that we must secure the maximum welfare, freedom and happiness of every citizen on the basis of social justice, equality of status and opportunity. That's what our constitution says. That's what the good legislator, the good minister must say. So I believe that we mustn't waste too much time on processes and procedures. We must do all that is in our power to serve the needs of our people. And those needs are urgent and they're immediate. It may sometimes mean walking the fine lines between law and reality, as Honorable Woodill put it. And there's law, there's reality. So we may not sometimes need to walk the fine line between law and reality. Excellencies, distinguished senators, you know, the real usefulness of this dialogue, I think, will depend largely on how we implement the suggestions that have been made. Mr. President, in his speech, already has said and suggested that we constitute technical working committees. And I think that also emerges in the wrap-up, which was so ably done by the Honourable Minister for the Federal Capital Territory. So I believe that the commitment has already been made. Mr. President has already committed to implementation. And I trust that the leadership of the National Assembly will do the same. I must commend the Planning Committee, the Secretary to Government, Senator Babajide Omoworare, and Honorable Umayo Yakub, assistants to the Senior Special Assistant to the President for National Assembly Matters, Senate and House of Representatives, respectively, and also all their collaborators in the National Assembly. So it is my very special pleasure and privilege to now declare this joint executive and legislative leadership retreat adjourned sine die. Thank you very much.